Our topic is a serious call to a serious faith. Acts 14:1, and it came to pass in Iconium that they went both together into the synagogue of the Jews, and so spake that a great multitude, both of the Jews and also of the Greeks, believed. Verse 21, and when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again, and so forth. I'll go down to verse 25. And when they had preached the word, go over to, well, let's just skip over for sake of time, chapter 17. Now, verse 1, now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was. If you underline or highlight your Bible, you ought to highlight that. As his manner was. You want to know how Paul operated? You want to know how he functioned? You want to know how he preached the gospel? As his manner was. He went in unto them, and three Sabbath days told his testimony, and got them all excited, and did signs and wonders, and had people falling all over. I'm sorry, I got the wrong translation here. As his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days, what? Reasoned with them. Reasoned with them. Maybe we should have called it a reasonable faith. A serious call to a reasonable faith. And he went to their own prophets, and he said, look what your prophets have said about the Messiah who was to come, and you cannot deny it has all been fulfilled in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth. This is the most powerful way to preach the gospel. And verse 10, the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. Well, Jesus had said, you know, the gospel is to the Jews first, and then to the Samaritans, then to the Greeks, and so forth. Verse 11, we have a ministry that we call the Berean Call, and this is where our the title of it comes from. And if you don't get our newsletter, I think at the book table we have some sign-up sheets. We send it out free each month, and you're welcome to have it. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily. We have a radio program. Some of you may have heard it. It's called Search the Scriptures Daily. That's where we get it from. They searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. And you need to check me out, check everybody out from the Bible. You need to know it for yourself. Verse 17, and Paul dialogued with the priests at the Temple of Diana, the Epicureans and the Stoics on Mars. Is that what it says? Therefore disputed he. In the synagogue, he was not an ecumenist. He didn't try to get along with everybody. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him. I mean, Paul's problem, he had never taken a Dale Carnegie course on how to win friends and influence people. The guy was so negative, he even said people were wrong. He even said they were going to hell if they didn't repent. Well, that's not the way to do it. But chapter 18, verse 4. I'm trying to get a point across here. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath, and I love this word, persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. We've got to persuade people. An awful lot of people that they think faith is some kind of a leap into the dark, you know. Well, I'm going to believe this. Well, we'll talk about that a bit. Verse 19, just skipping through a few verses here. And he came to Ephesus and left them there, but he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. And then we go down and talk about Apollos. A certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in the scriptures. Go to verse 28. For he, that is Apollos, mightily convinced the Jews, and that publicly showing or proving by the scriptures that Jesus was the Christ. That's what we're supposed to do. Go to chapter 19 and verse 10. This continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. That's what we're supposed to preach. Verse 20. So mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Verse 26. Now these are his critics. Moreover, you see and hear that not alone at Ephesus, but almost throughout all Asia, this Paul hath persuaded and turned away much people. Praise God for Paul. This Paul hath persuaded and turned away much people, saying that they be no gods which are made with hands. Well, let's just jump over to chapter 24. Verse 24. And after certain days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewess, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment, Paul is reasoning, Paul is persuading, Paul is disputing. He has a message, and you can't compromise it. And if you do, people are lost. That's the whole point. As he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled. I don't see too many people trembling today. I'm sorry, I don't think you tremble when you... Oh, I shouldn't say it, but when you watch Paul and Jan Crouch on TBN... I wonder where the fear of God is. Felix trembled. He tried to put him off. Go to verse 28 of chapter 26. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. Paul is persuading governors and kings and the Sanhedrin, and the Jews, and the philosophers, everywhere that he goes. But we want to talk a little bit about a serious call to a serious faith. And one of the reasons, we've just finished a book by this title, and it should be out in a few months, I don't know when the publisher gets it published. But they didn't like a serious call to a serious faith. It didn't look good on the cover. So they changed it to an urgent call to a serious faith. But anyway, you know, there are a lot of people. One of the reasons why I'm concerned about this, I travel a lot around the world and meet a lot of people, get to a lot of churches. And there are an awful lot of people who lose their faith. Lots of them. Thousands of them. I was speaking in a certain place, I won't mention it in case somebody hears the tape, but in the East, just a few weeks ago, and a mother, very concerned, drove many miles with her young son, about 20 years old, and stayed in a motel overnight, came to my meeting that night, and next morning called me where I was staying and asked if she could bring her son over. Well, of course, I wanted to talk to him on the phone, see whether he was willing. But make a long story short, here's a young man who had been a professing Christian, had been a counselor at camps, had been on a mission to foreign countries, had been a leader, seemingly an outstanding Christian, and then he denied everything. He was part of a skeptics club, an atheist club, fighting against the Bible and against the gospel. And his mother was hoping that I might spend some time with him, which I did. How can we explain this sort of thing? What went wrong? Maybe nothing went wrong. Maybe it finally went right. Maybe he found out in time that he wasn't really a Christian. It'd be tragic for people to go on thinking they're Christians and find out too late that they're not. I think if a person really knows God and they really know Christ and they really have a solid foundation for what they believe, they know what they believe and why they believe it, I don't think you can dissuade them from that. I think we're often not careful enough to explain the truth, to explain the gospel clearly. And I don't want to just make you laugh. I'm trying to illustrate something, but you may have heard of the story of the Texan and the Newfie. Maybe most, well, you're in Southern California, you don't know what a Newfie is. A Newfie is a Newfoundlander. They're the Canadian Polacks. And in Canada, they make jokes about the Newfies. And the Texan met the Newfie, and the Texan said, what do you do? And the Newfie said, well, I've got a farm. And the Texan, of course, you know what they're interested in. Well, how big is it? And the Newfie said, oh, it's one of the biggest in Newfoundland. It's 200 acres. The Texan says, 200 acres? I mean, you want to know how big my ranch is? I start out in my pickup truck in the morning before the sun is up, and I drive all day as fast as I can go, and by the time the sun goes down at the end of the day, I haven't even got to the end of my property. What do you think of that? Newfie says, yeah, I had a truck like that once too. So, people have can attach different meanings to what we say than what we intended. And I'm just trying to illustrate the point, we have to be very careful in what we say and that we make it convincing and persuasive, as Paul did. Paul, I should quote, we could quote, I mean, there are a lot of other verses we didn't get to, but you know 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11, Paul says, weep knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Well, there are a lot of youth groups, and they work more on emotion than truth. I think that's one of the problems. They're long on getting everybody worked up and enthusiastic, excited about Christ, but with not much reason for really being excited. They're excited about being excited. And they're enthusiastic about being enthusiastic. And about growth. And wow, and Christianity is being popular. And man, David Robinson and Reggie White, they're Christians. Wow! Well, I'm not putting them down for that. Praise God. But I think we need some solid reasons why we believe what we believe. Last week, I took time to take a couple of high school seniors out to dinner, and their parents were concerned about them, thinking that they had, you know, again, they lost their faith, they didn't believe God existed, and so forth. They're being influenced by the world, and by the end of the evening, these guys had completely turned around. Well, about 3 hours. They were enthusiastic. I hadn't worked on their emotion, but on their minds. And one of them said, I've never heard anything like that in any youth group I've been in. I think there's been an erosion of the faith for a lot of reasons, and one of them, I have limited time, I don't want to wear you all out. And a friend of mine just stopped by, and I made him promise he wouldn't snore because he claimed he was going to go to sleep. But anyway, A number of reasons, and we won't have time to talk about all of them, but one of them that I would like to mention is the church has been intimidated by science. By science, falsely so called. They have been so intimidated, they've embraced evolution. Can you imagine that? Something called theistic evolution. I don't know if you remember, a couple of years ago, last October, the Pope came out with a declaration. You remember that? He believed in evolution. Well, it's an established fact. And I had calls from radio stations wanting to interview me. I even had a call from a reporter from the New York Times. Mr. Hunt, the Pope believes in evolution. What's your reaction to that? And I said, reaction? Why should I have a reaction? That's what the Catholic Church has always believed. I mean, you want to go back to 1981, at the Pontifical Academy of Science at the Vatican, they had scientists from all over the world honoring Darwin on his 100th anniversary of his death, saying that Darwinism is a thoroughly established fact. You want to go back a little farther to the 1967 New Catholic Encyclopedia? It says evolution is a thoroughly established fact. But the Pope was very careful. He said, we'll stand on this. You know, Cardinal O'Connor, New York's St. Patrick's Cathedral, he said Adam and Eve were a couple of anthropoid critters. But we're not going to compromise on this, folks. And that is, when they got close enough to humanoids, God put a human soul and spirit in them. Not going to compromise on that. Well, what do you know? Christianity Today had an editorial agreeing with the Pope. What do you know? Promise Keepers New Man magazine said, yeah, that's right. And maybe I shouldn't mention this name. I don't want to shock you too much. Billy Graham said, yeah. Oh, it could have happened by evolution. Why not? I'll tell you why. Well, there's a lot of reasons why. But one of the reasons is Adam is named 30 times in 10 books of the Bible. Did you know that? Jesus quoted about Adam and Eve. Jesus apparently believed in the story of Adam and Eve. And if that's a myth, he's not God. Okay? You cannot reconcile God's statement in the Bible that he created man out of the dust of the ground. By the way, one of my favorite little sayings is, you know, the scientists got so smart, they challenged God. And they said, we can do anything you can do. God said, you can create life? Yeah, we can create life. You can make a man? Yeah, the scientist said. You made a man out of dirt? We'll make a man out of dirt. God said, no, you don't. You make your own dirt. But anyway, the Bible says God took the dust of the ground and he made Adam. And then Adam was around for some time, wasn't he? He named the animals. And God saw that he was lonely. He needed a partner. And he put him to sleep. And he took a rib. And he made a woman. You cannot reconcile that with two critters evolving side by side, male and female, and then getting zapped with a human soul and spirit. It doesn't fit. It gets even worse. What does Romans 5 tell us? By one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Okay? But if we got these critters evolving and dying for millions of years, you've got death before Adam sinned. We have destroyed the gospel. Now, let me ask you just a simple question. I mean, I like to be logical. I want to reason like Paul did. I want to reason with you this evening. I'm going to have to take the Bible as a package. If I don't, then I become the one who decides what part of it is true and what part of it is unscientific. And if I cannot accept what the Bible says about the origin of man, why should I believe what the Bible says about the destiny of man? If I cannot accept what the Bible literally says about man's fall and his separation from God by sin, Why should I believe what the Bible says about man's reconciliation to God and his redemption from sin? It's that simple. But we have an awful lot of theologians in our evangelical seminaries and evangelical colleges, and I could name them, who believe in theistic evolution. You cannot reconcile theistic evolution to the Bible. It won't work. Evolution of any kind. And some of them say, and in fact, I'm not trying to run Billy Graham down, but I want to just show you how high this sort of thinking has gone. Billy Graham's not sure that the flood was universal. He has said this publicly, so I'm not telling any secrets. There are many of our professors in our seminaries. Well, we're not sure that the flood, I mean, you know, the scientists say the flood, well, I could tell you a book called Cataclysm by a couple of atheistic scientists, and they tell you it was universal. I mean, I could give you all kinds of scientific evidence for it, but anyway, what does the Bible say? The flood wasn't universal? It says everything that had breath died. Doesn't it say that? The whole purpose of the flood was to wipe out all flesh, and the Bible says only Noah and his family remained alive, right? Isn't that what it says? It says the highest mountains were covered. Isn't that what it says? Furthermore, Jesus likened the coming judgment to the flood, and so did Peter. And Peter said, the world that then was perished in water. So the world that now is held in store against the fire of God, which will destroy this earth. But don't be upset, folks. It was a local flood, so it'll be a local fire. And I know that none of you has seen a rainbow, because God put a rainbow in the sky, you know, over there in Mesopotamia where they had that local flood to just help those people assure them that there wouldn't be another local flood again. Come on! I'm going to have to go by the Word of God. I'm going to have to take it for what it says. And this is the foundation for what we believe. We're talking about a serious faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? The Word of God. But if I can't be sure that all of it is accurate, I'm not going to be intimidated by science. There's a battle for the Bible, and I don't know if you realize how important it is. You haven't gotten it yet, the February newsletter. In our newsletter, we have an article, then we have some quotes that I think are really terrific, and then we have a Q&A section, which usually has two or three questions that come in. We get so many of them, and our response to them. But in the February newsletter, and I had to condense it, I only have one Q&A. And I don't even give you the question. I tell you, go to the internet if you want, on our website, and we'll give you the whole question. I kind of condense it because there isn't room. It's from a Muslim. He's very upset with me. And if you want to know what Islam teaches, one of our books, Cup of Trembling, we'll give you quotations from the Quran. One of our problems is we are not informed. Do you know that Islam teaches that Jesus did not die? Well, he's not the Son of God, he's not God. He didn't die on the cross for our sins. He didn't even die. He didn't die in our place. Somebody died in his place. And Jesus, if you can imagine, pleaded with a look-alike disciple to take his place on the cross. And he was taken to heaven, and he's going to have to come back and die. He's the 27th prophet, and Muhammad is the 28th. And this man was a little upset by some of the things. Somebody had published something that I had said on their website. And I thought you might, I just brought a little bit, and later on I might just quote a little more out of his letter. He says, listen to this, Jacob is not the father of the Jews. His descendants are called the children of Israel, of which many were Muslims. He says, the Bible claims that Abraham was to say, and then he goes on, he says, it wasn't Isaac who was offered on the altar. It's not the, Isaac is not the son of promise. He says, the Bible claims that Abraham was to sacrifice his firstborn son. Ishmael was his firstborn son, as clearly stated in the Bible. Regardless of who his mother was, the fact remains that Ishmael, not Isaac, was his firstborn and therefore the one to be sacrificed. It is only out of arrogance that the authors of the Old Testament disparage Ishmael and claim Isaac was to be sacrificed. Well, the Arabs aren't even the descendants of Ishmael. If we have any Arabs here this evening, that's not insulting them. Read it in your own Arabic encyclopedias, because you know that the descendants of Ishmael, they intermarried with the descendants of Esau. They intermarried with the descendants of Abraham and Keturah. After Sarah died, Abraham remarried. They're a mixed race. So even if you can't trace them back to Ishmael, but even if you could trace them back to Ishmael, the Bible very clearly says that Isaac is the son of promise, not Ishmael, okay? In fact, Ishmael was sent away with Hagar, his wife, his mother, before Isaac was offered. Doesn't he say, take Isaac, thine only son, whom thou lovest, so that Ishmael wasn't even recognized anymore as a son. He will not be heir with Isaac. But anyway, we have an attack upon the Bible. And one of the things that I said was, you know, the God of the Bible is called Jehovah, Yahweh. Can you imagine how many times? 9,000 times in the Bible. And he's trying to tell me that Allah is the God of the Bible. I said, wait a minute. You go to Israel today and you go inside the Dome of the Rock. They have verses from the Quran inscribed in Arabic inside the Dome of the Rock. And one of the verses says, Allah is not a father and he has no son. And he's arguing that, of course, he doesn't. And they changed the Bible and so forth. And one of the things I said to him was, the Bible mentions Jerusalem over 800 times. It's called the city of David 40 times. And the Quran doesn't mention it once. How come? How come Allah doesn't talk about it? How come in the Bible, God, and even Jesus called him this, and at the burning bush when he revealed himself to Moses, he said, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And listen to what he said. This is my name, and this is my memorial throughout all generations. 12 times in the Bible. And I said, how come Allah never calls himself that? In fact, Allah was the chief idol in a pagan temple, the Kaaba, which still exists today. And although Muhammad destroyed the idols, he kept the name Allah, the chief idol of the Quraysh tribe, his tribe. And he still has the brown stone that's there about 5 feet above the ground, just right for kissing you. It sucks all your sin out of you. And this was an old pagan practice before Muhammad was born for centuries. And yet the Muslims still practice it today. Okay, well, anyway. He says, you say that Islam was spread by the sword. Read the history of Islam. Islam was spread by Muslims going around the world and trading fairly and marrying the indigenous peoples of the countries they visited. These people saw how fair and righteous the Muslims were, and it impressed them so much that they accepted Islam. What? I wouldn't recommend that you ladies adopt Islam and be married, because a Muslim can have 4 wives at one time. Now, he can have an unlimited number of slave girls that he has sex with and concubines of all kinds, but no more than 4 wives. But as soon as he makes one of them pregnant and has the child, then he can say to her, I divorce you 3 times. I divorce you times 3. She's gone, and he can have another one, okay? But the Muslims are very fair. They didn't spread it with the sword. Really? Muhammad planned 65 campaigns. He led 27 of them himself. Pillage and plunder and destruction and slaughter. And maybe you don't know it, but after the death of Muhammad, it was so horrible that all of Saudi Arabia, practically, deserted Islam. They wanted no more to do with it. And what do you know? They were compelled back into the faith with the sword in what was called the Wars of Apostasy. And tens of thousands of them were killed. And you know, it was spread by the sword everywhere. I'm not here to talk about that, so I better move on. But it is a little bit discouraging because people somehow don't seem to be willing to face the truth. People believe what they want to believe in spite of the evidence. I remember when I was in the business world many, many years ago, a friend of mine had a little sign, maybe you've still seen it, I don't know, on his desk, and it said, "Don't confuse me with facts, my mind is made up." And that's pretty much the way it is today. Well, evolution has been an implacable enemy of the gospel. The whole purpose of evolution is to show that there is no God, that the world happened by chance. And I don't think parents and pastors and youth ministers are even aware of how thoroughly brainwashed the average young person is in public schools, even though they've been raised in a fine Christian home, a good evangelical church. And I think, unless we specifically refute evolution and some of the other lies that are being taught, they are trying to, for example, push homosexuality in the public schools. You have Project 10 right here in Los Angeles system. And they're trying to pass it off as something that's normal and natural. And I won't get off on a long thing about that, but it has always been known as the crime against nature because it is unnatural. And let me just give you just a little bit of an insight. It is a violation of the very first command God gave, which was before the Ten Commandments. What was the first commandment God gave? Genesis chapter 1, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And homosexuals, lesbians, do not do that. It is a rebellion against God. And in fact, if everybody adopted it, it would be the destruction of the human race. Okay? And that's why they have to prey upon other people's children, because they don't have their own and they want to corrupt them. And I was mentioning that just briefly, about that briefly, in a Calvary Chapel, believe it or not, no reflection on Calvary Chapel, about 3 weeks ago or so. And people were talking to me, and a young lady was standing there and finally thrust a note into my hand. I asked her to stay, I'd be happy to talk. No, she took off. And the gist of the note was that I had insulted her as a lesbian, and that if lesbians wanted children, they would adopt them. Well, that was exactly what I said. But if everybody's a lesbian, there aren't any children to adopt. And I guess I had also said, maybe what really insulted her was, I said, I don't understand how you can have gay pride parades and gay pride day when, if you want to face the facts, homosexuality and lesbianism reduces your life expectancy about by 50% and spreads disease, and it is horrible. Okay, how you can have gay pride. But anyway, they have somehow managed to impose this idea upon society so that the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the psychiatrists, they voted. They voted to make it normal. And you know what was going on when they voted to make it normal? The homosexuals were out there threatening to cut the power on their convention if they didn't come up with the right kind of a vote. This is not science, folks. You don't vote on science. But anyway, you have some Catholic seminaries where they say, I'm not saying it, they say up to 70% homosexuals. Really, that's in the genes. How is it this strange that the people that had it in their genes all gravitated to Catholic seminaries? Isn't that amazing? And I mean, if you believe in evolution, evolution would wipe this thing out, wouldn't it? In one generation. Because they don't procreate. So they wouldn't have any descendants. And it would be taken care of. Well, you know, if I think maybe it's important enough just to, I know Roger has talked a lot about this, and let me just put it like this. I don't even have to talk about fossils. Let's go to the mathematics of it, okay? Just as quickly as I can. I think it might be worthwhile. Let's just go to the mathematics, okay? You have 26 letters in alphabet, right? How many combinations of those 26 letters are there taken 26 at a time? Well, you kids that are taking your math, it's 26 factorial. That's what they call it, exclamation mark. 26 times 25 times 24 times 23 times 22 and down to 2, okay? It's a number about that long, 400 and something septillion. I don't even know what to call it, all right? Now, Richard Dawkins, one of the world's leading evolutionists, in his book, The Blind Watchmaker, he says, the nucleus of every cell has a digitally organized database with information content larger than the 30-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Okay? Now, can you imagine the odds of by chance getting all those letters lined up in the proper order, and if one of them's out of the order, it won't work? So there was a gentleman named Sir Fred Hoyle. He's not a Christian. He's a mathematician, astronomer, one of the world's leading mathematicians and astronomers. He just went to his computer. He said, look, you've got to get so many, just even to have the basic enzymes of life, to have DNA. You've got to line thousands of molecules up in the right order. And so he said, let's suppose that the whole universe is made out of the stuff of life, stirred around for billions of years. What are the mathematical laws? Now, you can't argue with this. This is mathematics, okay? This is not speculation. This is mathematics. You've got to get so many of these molecules lined up in the right order, just at the molecular level. And he went to his computer. He said, what are the chances you can get the basic enzymes? You know, I'm not a biologist. I don't know much about anything. But if you don't have enzymes, nothing works, okay? So what are the odds we can get the basic enzymes necessary for life? Well, he calculated it mathematically. You can't argue with it, folks. It was 10 to the minus 40,000. Now, if you're not a mathematician, you don't know what that means. So let me explain it to you. That's one chance in one with 40,000 zeros after it, okay? Now, you laugh, but we don't even know what that number is. Let me try to explain it to you. What are the odds that by chance, zooming through the universe at hyperspeed or, you know, whatever they can do, you can reach out and by chance pluck a particular electron out of this universe? Have any idea? That's one chance and one with 80 zeros after it. All right, let's take every electron in the universe, and let's make another universe out of each of them. Now what are the odds that zooming through all these universes, you can reach out and you can pluck a particular electron out of all of those universes? It's one chance in one with 160 zeros after it. You better believe one chance in one with 40,000 zeros after it never will happen. It is a joke. It is a fraud. And Sir Fred Hoyle says, and they all know it. Well, he says, how come they keep teaching it? Well, his explanation is because it's academically respected. Well, the real reason is because the only alternative means God, and we're accountable to Him, and they don't want it. It's a tragedy that our kids are being taught this in public schools. And some parents, you don't know how deeply those thoughts have been implanted. And the kids may seem to be going on along, you know, with everything that mom and dad are teaching them and so forth in Sunday school, but they've got a seed planted in there, and it's going to bear fruit, and we need to give them the facts, the evidence. We need to reason with them, as Paul did. Now, maybe you're not aware of this, but Clarence Darrow, you remember the famous trial back there, the Scopes trial? You know what his argument was? His argument, in those days, they taught creation in public schools, right? His argument was, it's not right to only teach one point of view. You gotta have two points of view. Let's bring in evolution too. And when the evolutionists got control, you try to get two points of view in there now. They won't allow it, okay? Well, these are some of the things that are happening. I don't want to depress you, but let me just give you a few facts. You know, you only need to look at recent history for verification of what I'm talking about. The erosion of faith. All of America's major universities, the first ones that were founded, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Brown, Dartmouth, Pennsylvania University, and so forth, they were Christian in origin. They were built upon a biblical foundation. And you look at them today. They are not only atheistic, they're anti-Christian. And one of the major things, I have a friend, well, Robbie Maharaj, some of you have heard Robbie, and Robbie Maharaj's cousin got a PhD in the philosophy of religion from Harvard. And he said it was a battle every step of the way, trying to destroy his faith, trying to undermine the Word of God. These people are the enemies of the gospel of Christ, and this is our young people are in their hands. I think we need to be aware of that. BBC, I'll just give you a few statistics to really depress you. BBC recently reported that many vicars in the Church of England don't even believe in God. These are vicars. These are pastors. They call God a man-made myth. The former Archbishop of Canterbury, Robert Runcie was his name, he said he didn't know why Christ had to die on the cross. And this is the spiritual head of the Church of England. He said God judges no one. The current Archbishop, George Carey, says, quote, Anglicanism at its very best can hold together Catholicism, Evangelicalism, Charismaticism, and Liberalism. A secular reporter described his visit to an Anglican church on Easter Sunday, quote, featured were songs by the Spice Girls, an immoral British rock group, whom the speaker said were the successors of Mary and Martha, the first Spice Girls. How about that? Well, I don't want to step on people's toes. You know, I try not to offend anybody. But you had maybe you're going to be spared because I didn't bring it in my notes. But anyway, I'll pass on that one, I guess. A little embarrassing, but I thought I had it here. But anyway, that's not an uncommon thing with me. Well, what do you know? Here it is. Some of you would be old enough probably to remember Marcia Stevens. She's the author of the popular song, Come to the Waters. For those tears I died. 1979, she divorced her husband of 7 years because she'd fallen in love with a woman. She lives openly as a lesbian. She claims God showed her, he accepts her. She continues to sing for the Lord, 150 to 200 concerts a year. And she has her own music label, BALM, B-A-L-M, Born Again Lesbian Music. Well, I could give you all kinds of examples of this sort of thing, of people that seem to start out well and something goes wrong. You probably know some of them. That's what I'm trying to reason about. How are we going to prevent this? We have to give people a solid foundation for what they believe. The Episcopal Church in America, it's a counterpart of the Anglican Church, tolerates similar unbelief. We could go back to California Bishop James Pike. You remember, any of you old enough to remember him? Bishop James Pike, he was a drunkard, an open adulterer. He denied all the tenets in the Bible. Interviewed by Look magazine, he boldly declared he didn't believe the fundamentals of the Christian faith. He called everything a myth, from the Garden of Eden to the virgin birth to the resurrection. 3 times he was brought up on heresy charges. Some people are a little concerned. But he was never convicted. He was never removed from office. He continued as the bishop of the Episcopal Church in California. Again, I don't understand, but Billy Graham insisted upon having him open one of his crusades in prayer. Wow. How is this possible? It seems that if you use God words, if you talk about God, you talk about Jesus, and you have a just kind of a religious vocabulary, then you can pass yourself off as a Christian. It's accepted because we don't want to offend anybody. We don't want to say somebody's wrong. I mean, that's negative. You shouldn't do that, you know? And so Jude, I mean, I don't think he could foresee down to where we are, but he said certain men have crept in unawares. Wow. I mean, I guess you might put it worse than that. We're not supposed to be judgmental. Have you heard that? You know, I have some ridiculous illustrations that I use, and probably some of you have heard them too many times. But anyway, here's a plane coming in for a landing, and the radar control tower radios to the pilot and says, "You're a half a mile south of the runway. Turn so many degrees to the north." And he radios back and he says, "You narrow-minded, dogmatic fundamentalist." There's only one runway. If you don't hit it, you've had it. It's that simple. I fly about too much, about 150,000 miles a year, if you can believe it. I'm a million plus miler with United Airlines, so they treat me kind of nice. But they won't let me do this. I've often wanted, at 37,000 feet, I'd like to get a hold of that mic. If I did, the FBI would be waiting for me when the thing landed. But I'll tell you what I'd like to say to them. I'd like to say, how many liberals do we have aboard? Hands go up, and I say, you know, well, I'm sure that you all hope we've got a liberal pilot flying this thing. A pilot who says, you know, let's not be narrow-minded dogmatic. I think one direction's as good as another. Why don't we just punch some buttons and see where it gets us? I guarantee you that every person flying every airplane, at least I hope on my airplanes, you don't tell this kind of a joke in the airport, I can tell you, but this guy comes up to the counter and he's a little bit worried. He wants to, you know, there could be a bomb on this plane. And the lady behind the counter says, well, it's not much of a chance. They've calculated about one chance in a million. I'm still scared. And she said, well, the chance that there would be 2 bombs on one plane would be 1 chance in 100 million. So why don't you take your own bomb aboard? I think most people flying on airplanes anyway, unless they're psychotic or suicidal, no matter what their foolish philosophical and religious ideas are, they hope in their heart they've got a narrow-minded, dogmatic, fundamentalist pilot flying this thing. A pilot who knows where he's going and follows the rules to get there. Okay? Now, it's that way in every area of your life. You laugh because it's so stupid. But how is it that when it comes to that which is most important, whether God exists or not, and man's eternal destiny, suddenly everybody wants to be broad-minded. And they will accept the most foolish ideas for what they believe. You wouldn't buy a refrigerator or a TV set on the evidence that they're happy with for their so-called faith. It doesn't make too much sense. Faith, faith is a word, and I wish I had another hour or two to talk about that. But Prince Charles, you remember? You know that the king or queen of England is the head of the Church of England. And they're required, when they ascend to the throne, they're required to take an oath to be defender of the faith. Prince Charles says, no, he's going to change it. Defender of faith, not the faith. You hear people say, oh, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious. I don't go for dogmas, you know. Just woo-woo by my, you could call them the woo-woo gang, you know. Just so long as you're spiritual, you know. Well, I'm going to skip a lot of this stuff, but the Dalai Lama was invited. I mean, you know, Buddhism is atheism. Dalai Lama runs around the world initiating people into Tibetan tantric deity yoga to show them that they're all little bodhisattvas, little Buddhas, that they can create their own universe with their own mind. And he gets the Nobel Peace Prize for that because he's going to bring peace to the world this way. He recently spoke from the pulpit of John Calvin's church in Geneva, Switzerland. Wow! He claims to be the 14th reincarnation, the original Dalai Lama. The cathedral dean, William McComish, general treasurer of the World Alliance of Reformed Churches, called the Dalai Lama His Holiness. And he praised his spirituality. And he declared that Calvin's Cathedral, which was once a major center of the Reformation, was, quote, I'm quoting him now, is becoming a home for a new religious center to experience understanding between the world's major faiths. By understanding, he means acceptance. If you understand the major faiths of this world, you know they're wrong. But by understanding, he says, well, we're going to all get along with one another. Dr. Edward Wilson of Harvard, he's a former Southern Baptist turned evolutionary entomologist, he says, quote, bitter experience has taught us that fundamentalist religion in its aggressive form is one of the unmitigated evils of the world. Now, I'm going to run out of time, so I better move on. But you know, in the name of unity, it seems to have been forgotten that souls are lost without the gospel of Jesus Christ, that there's only one way. We've forgotten the price Christ paid, and there's very little trembling in the presence of God. Who knows the terror of the Lord that caused Paul to persuade men? It's the broad road that leads to destruction, and it's the narrow way that most people despise and few follow that leads to life. We're trying to be relevant. And again, I don't want to be critical. And I know that some of these prayer breakfasts started out well. Presidential prayer breakfast. Let me just give you something from the 1993 presidential prayer breakfast in Washington, D.C. We've got a humanistic gospel that's being presented at these prayer breakfasts, so that no one will be offended, because you know who's there? Well, President Al Gore is our tree-hugging, I'm vice president, sorry. He worships Gaia, Mother Earth. He does. Read his book. At the prayer breakfast, he said, quote, faith in God, reliance upon a higher power by whatever name, is in my view essential. Isn't that great? That was an admirable declaration, so bold for this man to speak about faith in God, by whatever name you want to call him. Well, Senator Kerry, he read John 3, 1 through 21. Some strange reason, I don't know why, he skipped verse 16. And he said Christ was speaking of spiritual renewal, and he said, quote, in the spirit of Christ, Hindu, Buddhist, Muslim, Jew, Christian, we're all meeting here, and there's renewal because we have a new president and a new vice president. Words have lost their meaning. We don't think logically, but emotionally. And I think a lot of people have gotten very excited about a Jesus that they don't even know, and he has no relationship to the truth that he claims to be. Am I being too harsh? I don't think so. I don't think I'm being, probably I'm laying it on the line as clearly as Paul would if he were here. Now, I'm going to really upset people, but I think Mother Teresa is an outstanding example. She said she loved all, you know, she's dead now. She loved all religions. She said, whatever God is in your mind, whatever concept you have of God, you have to accept it. And she said, I'm only trying to draw you closer to God as you conceive him to be. And if you're a Buddhist, I'll help you become a better Buddhist. If you're a Hindu, I'll help you become a better Hindu. If you're a Muslim, I'll help you become a better Muslim. This is in writing. It's in any number of interviews. And when I said that, people got really upset because leading evangelicals praise her. But this is what she said. And John MacArthur went to Calcutta and he interviewed her. And he verified that what I had said was true. He said, she's giving false comfort to the dying. Well, Paul disputed. He reasoned. He persuaded. And if you have a faith for which you don't have proof, you don't have solid evidence, then I don't think you have a biblical basis for your faith. I was saying that at a church where I was speaking. And I said, I like to go to a university, and I don't care how many PhDs or professors or whatever in the audience, I tell them, I will prove to you that God exists. I will prove to you that the Bible is God's Word. I will prove to you that Jesus Christ is the true and only Savior of sinners. And I challenge anybody to refute it. If you're going to debate with me, you are going to lose. Not because I'm so smart, but because the Bible is the truth. This is the Word of God. And about five people came up to me afterwards. I'd never had a challenge like that. And they said, now, wait a minute. If you can prove it, where's faith? I mean, if you can prove it, why do you have to have faith? I said, maybe you have a wrong idea of faith. Faith is not a leap in the dark. You just decide to believe something. You better have a reason for what you believe. I mean, why are you a Christian and not a Muslim? Oh, well, I was raised in the Christian country. Well, yeah. Well, why do you believe what you believe? You don't just decide to have faith in anything. Is it biblical to prove? Acts chapter 1. After to whom? It's talking about Jesus. You know, the former treatise have I written, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach, and so forth. After his passion, he showed himself alive by what? Many infallible proofs. When he stood in the midst of them, and they, oh, it's a ghost. Jesus said, look, take it by faith. No, he said, handle me and see. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm really serious about this because I think we've got a lot of people who just have an emotional attachment. And they're really not saved. And I don't want to really make you laugh, and I shouldn't, but I told this story last night, and I hope you can calm down quickly, but I think it's illustrative. You know, this preacher, he had a strange habit. In his sermons, he would pound on the desk and say, and if that's not the gospel truth, may the devil come and take me. And it kind of got to some of the young people in one Halloween. Some of them rented, one of them rented a devil's costume, and the others dressed up like demons. And they're hiding back there. And sure enough, he doesn't get far in his sermon. He says, and if that's not the gospel truth, may the devil come and take me. And here they come. And he took off, and everybody's scattering in all directions. And one lady was a little too heavy, and she got stuck halfway out of a window. And they're behind her with pitchforks, and she's saying, Satan, don't do that to me. I've been a member of this church for 20 years, but you know I've been on your side the whole time. Oh. Well, there may be more people like that than we know. And I'm trying to get serious here. Let's just go through something very quickly. Let's start with the universe. You know that the sun hasn't been in the sky forever, right? If it had been in the sky forever, it would have burned out, right? So we know there was a time when it wasn't there. We know there was a time when all the stars weren't there. We know there was a time when this universe wasn't here. Second law of thermodynamics tells you that. It's running down like a clock. If it had been here forever, it would have run down by now, right? So there must have been a time when it wasn't here. Well, what was here? Something had to always exist, and it couldn't be matter, because matter is temporal. It couldn't be energy. So where did the energy for the Big Bang come from? It would have worn itself out before the Big Bang started. And why was there a Big Bang? And how do you get a human brain out of a Big Bang? And all of you people are really stupid listening to me, because the very thoughts that I'm expressing are simply the results of the antecedent motions of the atoms in my brain that all began with a Big Bang, and it's been progressing by chance, and it's all meaningless. I mean, you can't believe that. We know there was a beginning, and the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There had to be someone who had the power to create out of nothing. By the way, that's why we don't use feminine language in the Bible for God, because a woman gives birth out of herself. The child is an extension of her. The universe is not an extension of God, and God does not give it out from himself, although Yang Gi Cho says he does with his imagination by visualizing. And God creates out of nothing. The scientists got to have dirt. And God said, you make your own dirt. Well, someone eternal. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, our bodies, I want to get serious about this, our bodies are made out of matter. That means they wear out. Mine's worn out faster than yours, most of you. But yours will too, if the Lord tarries. It happens to all of us. Bodies wear out. But there's a soul and a spirit inside that does not wear out. Now, we can prove that matter is destructible. Second law of thermodynamics, it goes from order to disorder, right? It's running down. It's becoming less and less usable. But we don't have any such understanding of soul and spirit. It's eternal. When a man puts a gun to his head, pulls the trigger, he can be assured of only one thing. He stopped the function of his brain cells. But the real person inside continues to say, how do I know there's a real person inside? How can I prove? I can prove it very simply. You are spirit beings living in a physical body. We give you all kinds of evidence for that. Very simple. You have thoughts that are not physical. See, the psychologists try to say, you touch hot, you learn about hot. You touch cold, you learn about cold. We're stimulus response mechanisms, you know. And all, well, Lenin, this bothered, maybe you're not aware of this. This is something that bothered Lenin to his dying day. Because he was a scientific, atheistic materialist. That's what communism is, okay? That's communism. And then it proceeds from there. And he said, man cannot even think of anything that doesn't exist. Was he right? He's right. Well, you say, no, I can think of pink elephants. Yeah, but pink exists and elephants exist. You go to a Star Wars film, you go to all this space odysseys, all this kind of stuff. The most incredible creatures that they can come up with out on those planets somewhere, what are they? They're a bizarre combination. A bizarre perversion of what we have on this earth, right? Some kind of an animal or whatever. They can't come up with something on their own. If you think you can, first person that comes up with a new prime color for the rainbow, stand up and describe it to us. You cannot do it. And what bugged Lenin was, you can only know what you have experienced in this universe. Every thought you have must be a response to something out there that stimulated that thought, okay? And then he rocks back on his heels and he says, where did the idea of God come from? You can't think of anything that doesn't exist, then how come you think of God? Have you ever seen God? Have you ever seen anything in this physical universe that looks like God, that acts like God? No. Well, where did the idea come? Wow, those preachers, they started this insidious idea. Yeah, but where did the preachers get the idea? Look, you have thoughts that have no counterpart in this physical universe. The man that sits in the courtroom, he doesn't like the decision. And he says, there ain't no justice in this world. What is he talking about? If it doesn't exist in this world, why is he complaining about the absence of something that he's never seen? Aha, because he knows it ought to be there. And there is something inside of him that judges the judgment of the judge. And he says the judge should have judged up to that standard. Because we are created in the image of God, who is perfect in justice, in truth, in holiness. And we have the capacity to recognize and to understand that. And you cannot escape that. It's a fact. You are not the sum total of the electric impulses, the chemical reactions in your brain. Your brain doesn't even think. I know people have told me that, but your brain doesn't even think. If your brain thinks, you would be the prisoner of your brain. Whatever your brain comes up with, you got to run around and follow whatever your brain wants you to do. No, you make choices, moral choices, and you cannot deny it. Your brain is a computer that you use to operate this body and to function in this universe in which our bodies live. You know, that means that we go on forever when the body dies. And the most solemn question you can face is, where will you spend eternity? Where will you spend eternity? You know, I got something too long to read, but I'm going to give it a try anyway. My time is going to be up. But there's a grave danger, I want you to listen carefully, in thinking that the brain makes me what I am. That's the theory behind psychiatry, behind psychology. And unfortunately, Christian psychologists go along with it. And I want to quote you a couple of experts from a book, Your Drug May Be Your Problem. These are experts, psychiatrists, and so forth. And listen to what they say. Regardless of their religion or philosophy, many educated and informed people have come to believe that most, if not all, of our psychological, emotional, and spiritual problems are psychiatric disorders best treated by specialists who prescribe psychoactive drugs. We have replaced reliance on God with reliance on medical doctors and psychiatric drugs. These men are not even Christians. Our emotional and spiritual problems are declared to be biological and genetic in origin. Feeling fatigued? Take Prozac. Feeling as though you've lost your enthusiasm or direction? Take Paxil or Zoloft. Feeling trapped in an abusive relationship? Take Effexor, Livox, or Lithium. Feel a little nervous? Take Xanax, Clonopin, or Ativan. Having trouble disciplining your child? Give the child Ritalin, or Dexedrine, or Adderall. Consider this. The human brain has more individual cells, that's neurons, than there are stars in the sky. And each neuron may have 10,000 or more connections, synapses, to other brain cells, creating a network with trillions of interconnections. The brain is the most complex organ in the entire universe. Those trillions of interconnections between brain cells are mediated by hundreds of chemical messengers, neurotransmitters, as well as by hormones, proteins, tiny ions such as sodium and potassium and other substances. We have very limited knowledge of how this works. We don't even know. Some theoreticians would urge us to look for biochemical imbalances, but these are experts, that's not my words. That's sheer speculation. Besides, this is very interesting. Listen to this carefully. Whose biochemical imbalance are we looking for? That of the child that is supposedly out of control, or that of the parent who can't control them? That of the child who has problems learning, or that of the teacher who somehow can't get the point across? Whose imbalance are we talking about? Well, he goes on, and I've got to just jump down. Listen to this. He says the notion that Prozac corrects biochemical imbalances is sheer propaganda from the biological psychiatric industry. But disruption of the biochemical reactions in the brain causing severe biochemical imbalances and abnormal rates of firing among brain cells is a proven fact about Prozac that cannot honestly be disputed by anyone who knows the research. Let me just give you a final couple of sentences here. The approach taken by, this is a psychiatrist talking, this is an expert, one of the top experts on psychoactive drugs. The approach taken by psychiatrists is both simple-minded and destructive. They almost always assume that the problem lies in the hardware of the brain, some biochemical imbalance. However, it is impossible to reduce a person's emotional suffering to biochemical aberrations without doing something morally destructive to that person. And some of these people say, what we need to do is face our problems, because trials and tribulations build character. They build strength. And to just, you know, for every little thing that happens, I'm not trying to put anybody down here, I'm just telling you what the experts say, to jump in with some drug that you're going to throw in your brain, it's the most complex organ in the universe, and to try to reduce a human being to the chemical reactions in the brain is morally destructive. Well, where are we going to go for the answer? We better go to God, we better go to His Word. And, you know, we've got a false gospel out there. I realize my time should be up here. I'm trying desperately. I think we have a false gospel being preached a lot of times, without sin, without judgment, without God's holiness, without fear of God, the idea that sin and rebellion is not our problem. We've just messed up our lives. And God wants to straighten them out for us. God is so eager. This false God's sole purpose is to make us happy and successful. The converts of this false gospel are excited that by their, quote, decision for Christ, unquote, God is now on their side and will bless their lives. I'm not trying to be sarcastic, but somehow God's justice, God's integrity, God's purposes, God's holiness, the awesomeness of God has been forgotten. And we have a self-centered, humanistic gospel about how we can get blessed. And I'm not saying that God doesn't want to bless us, but I think the greatest blessing He can give us is to get a view of Him. I think we have a low estimate of God, of God's integrity, and last night I was talking about the non-negotiable gospel, another fellowship over in Torrance. I gave them a number of reasons why the gospel is non-negotiable. It's God's gospel. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was promised by the prophets. It doesn't change. It comes from the Bible, and I didn't have time to get to one. I just want to leave you with this. God's integrity is another reason why the gospel is non-negotiable. And I want to suggest something to you. And I don't think they're going to haul me off of here as a heretic. But let me suggest, and it's a horrible thought, because one of the questions that people throw out if God is a God of love, why does anybody end up in hell? You know what? I believe that God is glorified by those who are in hell. You know why? Because He didn't cave in. He said, the soul that sinneth, it must die. Jesus wept in the garden. He sweat, as it were, drops of blood. Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Don't make me go through this. If people can get saved any other way. And God's, pardon me, God said no. Why are people in hell? Because God didn't do like some of us as parents and grandparents. He didn't cave in to their pleas and didn't change what he said. A lot of us as parents have trained our kids to realize we don't mean what we say. I mean, I've seen it. Little girl, little boy does something, mommy says, you do that again, you're going to get it. They just go ahead and do it. Nothing happens. If God acted that way, we couldn't trust him. I can't trust God's promise of heaven if his threats of hell don't hold up. Are you following me? And I think it will be to his glory, to his integrity, to the strength of his character and his principles. He did not cave in and sneak somebody in another way. It would be a slap in the face to Jesus Christ. When Jesus pleads, if there's any other way, he dies on the cross. Why? You know, we've broken God's laws. That's not just a simple thing. That's not like you get 20 years and you get paroled at the end of five or whatever. We would be separated from God forever and forever and forever by our sin. We're rebels. That's what we are. We can't pay the penalty. God could pay the penalty because he's infinite. But it wouldn't be just because he's not a man. So God became a man through the virgin birth. He didn't cease to be God. He'll never cease to be man. He's the one and only God-man. That's why there's a Trinity. I mean, there's a lot of reasons why there's a Trinity. And he offers, he paid the penalty. He paid the penalty for our sins. I was trying to explain last night, and I just give me another minute or two here. You know, people get very emotional, and we should, about Christ being nailed to the cross. And the torment, the torture, what they did, they beat him and spat in his face and plucked the hairs from his cheek and scourged him and nailed him to a cross. You know what? That wouldn't save anybody. I hope you understand that. That's what we did to him. That would only add to our condemnation. Where does our salvation come from? As he hung upon the cross, Isaiah 53, it pleased Yahweh to bruise him. Thou hast put him to grief when thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. He became the sin sacrifice. And he paid the penalty that his own infinite justice required. Maybe some of you have never understood that. Maybe you never believed it. Maybe you've believed in kind of a, I don't know, an inspirational Jesus. Wasn't it wonderful that he was willing to die for his principles and so forth? And I don't know. But this is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not negotiable. It doesn't change. It's the only way. It's the only hope. It's the only thing that makes sense. You can't pay for the penalty for your sins. And salvation is a gift. You can't pay for a gift. You can't earn a gift. You can't merit a gift. If I give this young man here, I give him something. I hold out maybe something. Maybe it's not worth much. Let's say I give him a painting or whatever. He insists on paying me for it. Insists on giving me even a penny for it. You know what he has done? He has rejected the gift, right? He has refused to accept the gift. The gift of God is eternal life. And you only get it by receiving it, by believing in him and believing that he paid the penalty that you couldn't pay. And you accept this by faith. You just believe in him. And if you don't take it that way, if you try to pay for it with your good deeds, your gifts to charity, your church membership, whatever it is, any little thing, you have insulted God. You have lowered the value of this gift to something you can do in exchange for it, and you have refused to allow God to give you this gift. And maybe some of you tonight never understood that. I hope that some of you at least understand it more clearly and can articulate this more clearly from the Word of God. It's what the Bible teaches. I'm going to just, let's just bow in prayer. I'm going to pray a prayer that I prayed 60 years ago. Just the summer, well, a few weeks before I entered the 10th grade. And it was when I met Jesus. And you could pray something like this in your heart. I'm not asking you to raise your hand, stand up, come forward, whatever. This is between you and God. Lord Jesus, I believe you are who you claim to be. I believe you are God. You came to this earth. You loved us so much. You came to this earth. Through the virgin birth, you became a man. You didn't cease to be God. You'll never cease to be man. You're the one and only God-man. You lived a perfect, sinless life. You had no sin of your own to die for. You're God. You're perfect and perfect man. And so you were able to die for my sins, not only the torment that men put upon you, but you took the penalty. Your own infinite justice demanded. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for taking my place and the penalty that I deserve. And I believe you rose from the dead. And you're knocking at the door of my heart. You want to come in. And Lord Jesus, I open that door. I receive you as my Savior, gratefully, thankfully. Thank you, Lord, for coming into my heart. Thank you for redeeming me. Lord, I pray for any who prayed that prayer tonight that they may have felt you come in, they may have felt nothing. We don't go by feelings. Help them to understand that. We go by your promise. You made a promise. And if they open that door, you came in. And you said you would never leave them nor forsake them. Help them to grow in their relationship with you and the study of your word, fellowship with other believers. And Father, I pray for all of us here tonight, myself and all the others, Lord, who know you. Oh God, help us to stand against the compromise, the confusion, and even the perversion of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And help us to persuade others to receive Christ. Lord, in the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to rescue many before it's too late. Now, some of you may have prayed that prayer, and if you would like further counsel, they have a prayer room over here, and you would be welcome to make your way over there sometime this evening, and there would be people there. I don't know what else is supposed to happen here. Rob, what happens next? They're excused, I guess. They want to get out of here.